want you to take a look now at these heartbreaking scenes outside Kabul Airport. They were just hours before those explosions overnight. We see desperate Afghan mothers handing over their children, babies, to Australian soldiers. Distressed families, their lives packed in plastic bags, walking through sewage drains, risking everything to escape life under Taliban rule. Now, just think about our soldiers here. Some have probably lost friends and comrades in this foreign country. Imagine the sense of helplessness, knowing that so many of the faces in front of them won't be saved. Well, we now know how unlikely that is this morning, because this is Kabul after two suicide bomb attacks overnight. Among the more than 70 dead, children and 12 US soldiers, amid reports of further attacks on the ground. For more, we're joined by Defence Minister Peter Dutton and Deputy Leader of the Opposition, Richard Marles. Thank you both of you for joining us this morning. Peter, I know we'd been warned, but a dark, dark day.
It's a horrible, horrible day, and I just grieve like every decent person would at the loss of life, and in particular for us, the loss of the American lives. These are people that have helped literally thousands of Australian citizens and visa holders, permanent residents, through those gates and through Abbey Gate into the airport, and they're the people that have been lifted. We've brought through literally hundreds of people through the Baron Hotel, and the Brits and the Americans were doing the security there for us. So our troops will be devastated by the loss of their comrades. These are people that they've worked alongside over the course of the last week. It's remarkable how many people they've brought out that they've saved, particularly women and children. But everybody is devastated by this. And we put out advice at 6:15 yesterday morning and had sent text messages, emails to Australians and those people that we knew in the vicinity to say vacate, because there was very clear intelligence that ISKP intended to strike, and to strike hard. They've done that. These are people who are even more extreme than the Taliban and are basically at war with the Taliban. So it is a horribly complex situation, and I'm very pleased and relieved that our soldiers have departed from Kabul, and we took the decision to lift the last of our people yesterday, and they are safely in the United Arab Emirates, and I'm very pleased for that.
Okay, so confirmation there that there are no Australian soldiers on the ground in Afghanistan anymore. We do know, though, that there were still dozens of Australian citizens and more than 1,000 Afghans with Aussie visas still there trying to get out. What happens to them now, Peter?
Well, obviously, it's a very difficult situation. There's advice that some people are getting to go to other borders, but there's great uncertainty there at the moment. We know that some Australians have travelled there in recent months, which has been very difficult for a number of reasons, to try and support family, etc. So it remains a very, very difficult part of the world, and will do for a long period of time. The Taliban have given assurances. We don't know whether we can accept that or not. We hope that commercial flights are available again soon. But as we've seen overnight, and as the intelligence continues to indicate, more terrorist attacks are likely. People should avoid gatherings, they should avoid public places, and they should be very careful of their own safety and security in what is a warlike condition.
So what exactly does that mean for the Australians still there? Is there any way for you as a government to get those people out, or is it on them themselves to try and find a way to escape Afghanistan?
Well, Ali, I think we should recognise that we've lifted over 4,000 people over the course of the last week. It's been quite a remarkable event. We've been going 24/7 as a country. The Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade, the National Security Committee's been meeting at least daily. The CDF and all of the defence planners and military experts, the intelligence experts, have been feeding into the operation. And the acts of bravery already by the SAS, by our commandos, by our soldiers, all of our staff on the ground is quite remarkable. I just make that point. And if we were to continue in that situation, we would have had casualties now as well. So in that situation, we can't continue to put our ADF personnel and their lives at risk. And that's the situation, the reality of what's on the ground at the moment, which hasn't made it possible for us to lift more people out.
OK, and look, we are standing by. We're expecting the US President Joe Biden to address the nation at any stage. And just to give you the heads up, gentlemen, we'll take that live for a few moments when it happens. But, Richard, such a desperate situation there right now.
Oh, this is completely tragic. It just seems to bring or put an exclamation mark on what has been a devastating few days, really, looking at what's played out in Kabul. It reminds us of how dangerous the work of our servicemen and women have been over the last few days. It reminds us of their bravery. And I think that's really what we should be focusing on now, whilst also obviously grieving for all of those who have perished and the American soldiers with whom we have been working in the last few days, but obviously who we've been working with over the last 20 years. I know a lot of people have done a lot of work over the last couple of days to get people out, and one of the tragedies of this is that it does make it very difficult going forward in terms of rescuing Australians from Afghanistan. But I think every Australian's heart is bleeding today for what just the terrible things that we're seeing in Afghanistan now.
Look, agree, and from both of you there, well said. Let's move on to the fact that National Cabinet will be meeting today. I mean, it's going to be interesting, isn't it, Peter, after the Queensland Premier, well, basically blindsided the Prime Minister yesterday, announcing plans for this quarantine camp near Toowoomba.
Well, Elliot, it was a surprise in one sense. There's a lot of local anger in relation to this project, so let's see what happens on the ground. And the idea that people are going to be bussed from Toowoomba to Brisbane will create a lot of health questions about whether or not that's safe and whether that's the best way, particularly in the close confines of a bus, to transfer literally hundreds of people. You're moving staff most likely in and out of Brisbane as well, that will be working in the quarantine facility. So there are a lot of questions that the Queensland Premier has, and not even the local mayor was aware of what I think the Courier-Mail described this morning as a political stunt by Stephen Miles. So I just think people are over this sort of stuff. People want us all to work together to get out of lockdown as quickly as possible, get their kids back to school, get to see their grandkids again. Mm. And that's what the Prime Minister is working toward with the Premier's at National Cabinet today. We want to focus on vaccinating kids and rolling that out, and there are other issues that will be agreed on today that will see us out of quarantine as quickly as humanly possible.
I mean, the thing that she's doing, I mean, the cab that you were going to build in Queensland alongside the state government there won't be ready till mid-next year. This 500 beds by Christmas time, we know hotel quarantine is full, but Richard, there is this problem of there are no flights there, and for that they need government, federal government approval. And can the local health system cope with positive cases?
Well, look, Anastasia is moving down this path because she's understandably exasperated by the complete failure of the federal government to do its job. It was a year ago that the federal government was given advice to build fit-for-purpose quarantine facilities, and it's the absence of those facilities which have seen hotel quarantine breaches at almost a rate of one a fortnight, and why we've now got the disease in Australia. So, you know, people can talk about all the issues associated with it. It would actually be a fit-for-purpose facility, and the fact that a state premier has felt the need to go it alone says everything about the extent to which the federal government has dropped the ball here. I mean, yeah, we all want to work together. We all want to get past this, and we all want to get past living in the land of the lockdown, but we also want our governments to do their job. And Scott Morrison has not done his, both on quarantine and on getting an effective vaccine rollout.
Look, I tell you what, National Cabinet will be interesting today when Scott Morrison presents the new Doherty modelling, but it's going to be, there are such clear, very different paths that different states and the federal government are looking at. It's going to be interesting to see how that one plays out today. Peter and Richard, thank you so much for joining us on what is a pretty difficult day. Thank you.